Hello students, my name is Bridget. We are going to proceed from where we left. We are going to start from public finance and inflation. That is topic number 7 of economics. And first, we are going to define terminologies used in public finance and inflation. So the first terminology is microfinance. There is microfinance, there is macro and microfinance. So we are going to start with macrofinance, macroeconomics. So macroeconomics basically concerns with allocation and distribution of resources to maximize social welfare. So macro, there is allocation and distribution of resources. So allocation and distribution, so allocation should concerns with taste and preference of the community, and it should be comfortably within the customer's taste and income. Also, allocation must be allocated in production of goods and services in such a way that there is non-relocation, increase the output of goods without decreasing the output of any other. So there is distribution of in economics, this is concerns with fair distribution of income and wealth. So there is macroeconomics. Macroeconomics is objective of government is to control employment and full employment. So there are these terminologies we have, macro and micro. The first one is macro economics, which is allocation. The second one is distribution. So the second one is macro. So macroeconomics generally concerns with inflation, high growth rates, full employment, balance of payments, equitable distribution of income, and others. So, there is also a budget. Now, before we proceed to budget, under macroeconomics, there is inflation, employment, and balance employment, and balance of payment, and others. So we proceed to budget. First of all, what is a budget? So, budget is a summary statement indicating estimate amount of money or revenue or resources that government requires and hope to raise. That is a budget. This is money or resources government requires and hopes to raise it. The function of budget. The first one is to raise revenue to meet government expenditure. The second one is a means of distributing wealth. And the last one is control level of economic activities. Those are functions of budgets. There are types of budgets. Number one is deficit budget. Number two is balanced budget. And the last one is surplus budget. So we are going to start with deficit budget. So deficit budget is whereby the purpose expenditure is greater than the planned. So deficits number one is deficit. So this one. So deficit is where the purpose expenditure is greater than the planned revenue. So this is where my expenses are more greater than the revenue itself we have. The second one is balanced. From the work balance. So balance is where expenditure is equal to the planned revenue. So in this one, expenditure is equal to the planned revenue. We go to the third example. So the third example is surplus budget. So this is where expenditure is less. Is less than the planned revenue. So deficit is where the expenditure is greater than revenue. Balance is where expenditure is equal to the planned revenue. And the third one is the surplus, whereby the expenditure is less than the planned revenue. We go to taxation. We are going to define what is taxation and the functions of taxation. So taxation is taxation is the purpose of imposing compulsory contribution on private sector to meet expenses which are incurred for common goods. So is the process of contribution to incur common goods. So examples of these common goods includes hospitals, schools, roads, and other government infrastructures. We go to functions and purposes of taxation. And the first one, the purpose of taxation is to raise revenue. The second one is to stabilize the economy. The third one is fair distribution of income. There is protection policy, social welfare, optimum allocation of resources, and to pay interest on national debts. Those are the functions of taxation. we go to the principle of optimal tax system. So the principles of optimal tax system are conditions fulfilled like equity, certainty, economy, and conveniences. There is classification of taxes. So classification of taxes, they are classified into four. Number one is regressive. The second classification is progressive. The third one is proportional, and the fourth one is decreased. So those are how taxes are classified. There's also direct and indirect taxes. So we start with direct taxes. And direct taxes impacts and incidents, they are impacts and incidents of taxes imposed on the same person. Those are direct taxes, are taxes imposed on the same person, and those taxes are legal, and they include income and estate duty. So we go to advantages of direct taxes. The first advantage of direct taxes is they satisfy the principle of equity. They satisfy the principles of certainty and convenience to taxpayers. The third one is they satisfy the canon simplicity, as they are easy to understand. The fourth one is taxes reduce income inequality. And the last one, taxes reduce wastage of public expenditure. Those are the advantages of direct taxes. And we go to disadvantages. Number one is income on illegal activities are not taxed. The second one is the cost of allocation is generally high. More taxes discourages people from working. It reduces people's abilities to save. When the taxes are high, you are unable to save, you are unable to work because you are being taxed a lot. Then taxes also, people can easily evade from tax as they can understand the source of income and other means. We are done with disadvantages and advantages of direct taxes. We go to indirect taxes. And indirect taxes are majorly imposed to traders and producers of goods. So, and these producers can pass these taxes from to the final consumer, their buyers. And we have advantages of indirect taxes. Number one, it's less costly to administrator. Number two, it results to high revenue collection. This is whereby governments can raise high revenue. Indirect taxes reach the pockets of all income groups. They can check on consumption of harmful goods. Number five, they can be used as powerful tool for implementing economic policy. So taxes can be used as a powerful tool for implementing economic policies by the government. We go to disadvantages of direct taxes. Number one, most indirect taxes are regressive. The second one may lead to inflation. The third one, revenue from indirect taxes is uncertain because it may not be accurately estimated. And sometimes they have adverse effects of production of commodities. So taxes also affects production of commodities. And inflation also, taxes, these indirect taxes can lead to inflation. So we go to these examples of taxes. We are going to start with number one, that is regressive tax. Regressive taxes is when taxes falls heavily on the poor. To the poor. So regressive is whereby taxes falls heavily to the poor. The second one, before we go to the second one, we are going to discuss the advantages and disadvantages of regressive taxes. Sorry, we don't have disadvantages and advantages of this. It's this one for progressive. So progressive is whereby the higher the income, the greater the proportional paid in taxes. So this one, the higher the income, the higher the tax. Proportional is whereby the size of income is the same as the percentage charged. So this is the income is the same as the percentage charged. So proportional is where the income is the same as the percentage charged in tax. We go to degressive tax, the last one. So this is where the higher the income do not make a due contribution on when the burden imposed on them is relatively less. So this is whereby the higher the income, the less the taxes. The taxes imposed. So we are done with classification of taxes, and we are going to discuss the economic effects of taxation. So generally, taxation has its advantages and disadvantages. disadvantages. So we are going to discuss the general effects of taxation. So number one, there will be a low-saving culture. When taxation is high, people will no longer save. Number two is discourages work. So maybe from your salary, you receive your income, they are much taxed. So you'll be discouraged to work because you are highly taxed. Number three is less profit is made. It causes inflation and decision of economic resources. So economic resources will not be distributed equally. We are done with taxation, we go to public expenditure. So public expenditure is money spent by government on projects and infrastructures. So the public expenditure is money spent by government on projects and expenditure. There is also a national debt, which is the borrowing. National debt is borrowing by governments, is money that government borrow for their expenses or expenditure. So there are types of public debts, types of public debts. Public debt includes productive and national debts. There are two. Public debt. Number one, that is national, and number two is public. So, no, sorry, national debts. So we start with productive debts. So productive debt is whereby loan is obtained to enable government to purchase some real assets, whereby debt is not covered by any real assets. So this is a loan borrowed by government to buy real assets, but these real assets cannot be paid back as a loan. And national debt, we have to marketable and non-marketable. So marketable is what we can buy or sell on money markets. So marketable is what can be bought and sold in money markets, and non-marketable is cannot be sold on money markets. So we go to also national debt. It has marketable and non-marketable. Also, it has domestic and external. So domestic is a loan whereby is a debt, sorry, whereby they are owned by citizens of the country. And external debts are debts owned by foreign institutions and governments. Those foreign institutions include IMF Bank and other banks. So in external debt, this one, we have bilateral lenders. That is under external debt. We have bilateral lenders. So these bilateral lenders are official lenders between two governments. Maybe we give examples like Kenya and China, Kenya and France, Kenya and USA. We have multilateral. So multilateral is lending from organization composing of many governments. So this is between two governments. This one is between many other governments. Organization composing of many governments like IMF, Bank, and other institutions. So we have a burden of national debts. We have burdens for national debts. The burden of national debts. So burden of national debts are depends on several factors. So for national debts to increase or decrease, there are factors which are present. So number one is population. The second one is government revenue, and the third one is national income. We are going to start with population. The second one is government revenue. The third one is national income. So those are three dependents on national debts. So the higher the population, the higher the debts. Then the lower the revenue, the higher the debts, and the higher the revenue. The higher the revenue, the lower the debts, and the higher the revenue, the higher the debts. So there is national income generally. When national income is higher, the level of borrowing is lower. And when the national income is lower, the level of debts increases. So we go to public sector borrowing requirements. What are the requirements for the government to make borrowings from other governments or other organizational institutions? Thank you. So we are going to discuss what are the requirements for the public sector to make borrowings. Number one is fiscal policy. The second one is monetary policy. And the third one is direct intervention. So we are going to start with fiscal policy. Fiscal policy. So fiscal policy referred to the multi-population. Referred to manipulation by government revenue and expenditure to achieve economic stability. So it refers to manipulation of government revenue and expenditure to achieve economic stability. And these policy objectives are associated with the following. So, under fiscal policy, objective to achieve the fiscal policy includes improving of balance of payments, counteracting inflation, increasing employment opportunities, redistribution of wealth, income, and moderating resource allocation and distribution, and adjusting price mechanism. Those are objectives. Objective associated with fiscal policy. The second one is monetary policy. So monetary policy is the direction. The first one. The second one is monetary policy. Monetary policy is the direction of economy through which variables of money supply and price and pricing of commodities. So monetary policy is the control of money supply and pricing of money. So those pricing of money includes the interest rates. Interest rates and loans. These are monetary. So we see the interest rates and the money supply. We go to the third one, direct intervention by governments. So governments intervenes to economy to see what can be carried out. What can be sold, what can be bought, and what to supply to this region, and the price income to the different job groups. Those are direct intervention by government. So those three are requirements of public sector borrowing. We go to difficulties in using fiscal policy. Difficulties of using that as a requirement on public borrowing. The first one is theoretical problems. The second one, net effects on budget. The third one is the time also affects. There is information whereby information is not accurate. Policy conflicts whereby there is no agreement between this party and the other one. There is also inflexibility in the government finances. This is This is whereby government has no finance. We go to problems of price and income policies. So problems of income and income policies. They include wages, drift, differentiation, distortion of market forces, discrimination, and confrontation. Those are the problems of pricing and income policies. Let's repeat. They include confrontation, discrimination, differentiation, wages, drifts, and distortion of market forces. So we go to the types of inflation, causes of inflation and impacts of inflation, and measures to control inflation. So we go to inflation. We are done with public finance and we go to inflation. Inflation is the situation whereby the purchasing volume is powerful than goods or services. So this is whereby people purchase, there is more demand of goods and services, but the goods and sales and services are lower. They are not there. And we go to causes of inflation. So what are the causes of inflation? Number one, wage cost. The second one is import prices. The third one is exchange rates. Let me write so that you can copy. Causes. We have the first one is wage cost, the second one is import prices, the third, these are when the import prices lowers, the third one is exchange rates. So this is whereby exchange rates go up, markup pricing. So these are the causes of inflation. You can write them on a notebook for future reference. So we are done with causes of inflation. We are going to impacts of inflation. These are the effects of inflation and the general effects of inflation to a country. These are the causes, we have effects. So effect number one, it can cause unemployment. Number two, inflation can bring about political instability. Number Number three, the effects of inflation can cause the domestic prices to go up than other countries' prices. Than the world market. So we have a loss of money value. The income distribution was the income distribution was the. So these are the effects of inflation. We have the causes, the effects. So we go to the control measures of inflation. Control measures of inflation. So, to control this inflation, we are going to use this one. So we have fiscal policy, monetary policy, and direct intervention. So to control inflation, there must be raising and lowering the level of aggregate demand. So this is raising and lowering the level of demand. As we say that inflation is whereby there is higher demand than the goods and services available. So we are going to use this policy to lower the demand and increase some production of goods. We go to the second one, the monetary policy. This is, we come to the causes of inflation. So we have the exchange rates. So under monetary policy, we are going to reduce inflation by monitoring the supply of money and interest rates. And the third one is direct intervention. This is whereby the government intervene on prices and income policy. So a government on this side might decide to increase the level of income of people and the price of other goods. So governments can increase the income and lower the price of goods and services. So students, we are done with topic number 7, that is public finance and inflation. And about this topic, questions which you might be asked, you can be asked to discuss the impacts of inflation to the economy. This one, you can be asked to discuss the causes of inflation, the definition of inflation itself, and the control measures of inflation, which we say there are fiscal policy, monetary policy, and direct intervention by government. Also, you can be asked to describe some terminologies like progressive tax, digestive tax, proportional tax, and progressive taxes, functions of taxation, budget, the types of budget and functions of budget. Look at what you can be asked from public finance and taxation. There's a definition of terms and discussion of the causes, effects, and measures to take to control inflation. So that's the end of topic number 7. And we are going to topic number 8. That's the last topic in economics, CPA 2. That's the final, the last topic. And that is international trade. So in international trade, we'll discuss the definition of international trade, the importance of international trade, restrictions on international trade. We have the definitions like economic integration, benefits of integration. We have what is balance of payments. We are going to discuss also the exchange rates and the factors determining the exchange rates. So that is international trade, all about international trade. It's a very short topic. So the first, we are going to define what is international trade. So international trade is exchange of goods and services between one country and another country globally. That is the definition of international trade, the trade between one country and another country globally. So there are reasons for developing international trade. And number one is the reason for developing is whereby some goods cannot be produced by one country. Number two is whereby some goods can be produced efficiently elsewhere. The third one is shortages can arise due to domestic demand. That's why you have to do the international trade. We have the theory of comparative advantage. The theory of comparative advantage. And comparative advantage is whereby countries produce a particular goods and services at a lower opportunity cost than trading partner. Let's say, for example, Kenya produce maize and also Tanzania produce maize. And Kenya sells their maize at a higher prices and Tanzania sells maize at a lower prices. That's an example and a definition of comparative advantage. We have gains or importance of comparative advantage. So comparative advantages includes exportation of surplus produce. The second one is importation of what cannot be produced in one country. The third one is specialization according to absolute advantage, absolute comparative advantage. This brings about specialization of specialization according to absolute advantage, and there is also specialization according to comparative advantage. And the fifth one is there will be introduction of new ideas. Also, comparative advantage stimulates competition among these countries. There's widening of choice to customers. That is, a customer can prefer to buy from country A and not country B. there is creation of employment and maintenance of employment. Those are the advantages of comparative advantage. So we are going to discuss the merits or disadvantages of comparative advantage. So disadvantage number one, comparative advantage can collapse infant industries. The second one, it can promote use of unpleasant goods due to importation and exportation. The third one is they can lead to shift in prices of commodities. So prices can shift if one country A realizes that their products are highly in demand. We have restrictions on international trade. And our reasons we are going to discuss the reasons for restrictions on international trade. The first one is cheap labor. The second one is infant industries arguments. So international trade can be restricted when these infant industries collapse. The third one is structural unemployment. It can somehow cause unemployment structurally. The fourth one is the danger of over-specialization. A country can really specialize on one product and leave other products. We have dumping. So these products can be produced in surplus and they can lead to a major dumping, and that is wastage. And there is also bargaining. So bargaining arises from the country which is importing and can lead to lower profits. So there are ways of restricting this international trade. Those are restrictions, and there are ways of restricting international trade. So ways of restricting international trades include tariffs, there are quotas, there are free trade, procurement policies, and other restrictions. So tariffs, we just write ways of restricting international trade. So there are ways of restricting international trade. Number one is tariffs. So tariffs generally includes the taxes and interest rates. So if we want to restrict international trades, we raise our taxes and interests. So the second one, we have quotas. We have quotas, and quotas are limiting the quantities. So a government can decide to limit the quantity so that a certain company cannot export or import this product. So this is the meaning of quotas. The third one is free trade agreement. So when there is free trade, other harmful commodities can be brought about. Can be brought to the country. have the fourth one, that is procurement policy by government. This is whereby a government ban can decide to ban import or export of a certain product to restrict this international trade. So government can use this procurement policy to do so. Also, we have other restrictions by government. Other restrictions include the safety of the products. And we are going to another topic, that is terms of trade. We are going to start with the definition of terms of trade. And terms of trade is the relationship between imports and exports. The relationship between countries' imports and export. Terms of trade. So, terms of trade, the relationship. So, terms of trade is the relationship between imports and exports. So, the relationship between exports and inputs. So, this terms of trade is calculated by dividing the imports, imports from exports and U times 100 to get the percentage. So there are factors affecting terms of trade, and factor number one is discovery of synthetic materials. The second one is raw materials. There is agricultural protection and inputs substitution. There is technical progress in manufacturing. So raw materials affect terms of trade. So the factors affecting imports and exports. These are raw materials. There is innovation, agricultural protection, and technical progress. So those are the factors affecting imports and exports. So we proceed to economic integration. And economic integration is various degree of economics and economic policies of more countries in a given region. So economic integration is the degree of economies and economic policy in a given countries in a certain region. So maybe in East Africa. So we are going to, so example, we are going to see the various degrees of economies and economic policies in East Africa, that is Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania. The economic policies include taxes, there are major terms of trade and others. So under economic integration, we have four terms that includes free trade, customs market, common market, and economic union. Those are under economic integration. Economic integration, we have economic integration. Thank you.
You have free trade.
Free trade and economic integration is whereby a number of countries agrees to abolish tariffs, quotas, and any other barrier to trade. So free trade is where these countries abolish tariffs, abolish this, abolish means of restricting international trade. That is free trade. We have customs market. This is whereby a countries agree to permit free trade among themselves. So free trade is to abolish the tariffs, and custom market is to agree to permit. We have the third one, which is a common market. This is custom market. This is common market. So a common market is whereby countries decide to form a custom market. So our countries decide to form a common market and permit factors of production in full mobility between them. So as we discussed the common market, the custom market is whereby a country agrees to permit free trade. And common market is whereby the countries decide to form a custom market union and permit factor of production. We go to the fourth. This is economic union. So economic union is whereby these countries agree to set up one currency. Let's say, for example, shillings. East Africa uses shillings. They share common currency and they agree to join one institution, one financial institution, so that they can trade. We have benefits of integration. Benefits of economic integration. The first one is economic integration and largest market system. The second one is industrialization. There's infrastructural facilities. So infrastructural facilities, those are like harbors, ports, airports, and airlines. There is also specialization, there is increase in employment and increased balance of payments. So we go to balance topic, and the topic that is balance of payment. So balance of payment is all a record of financial transactions between residents of that country, maybe residents of Kenya and residents of foreign country, residents of Kenya, the financial transaction between residents of Kenya and residents of USA. There is a structure of balance of payment. We have the structures of balance of payment. We have the structure. So structure number one, we have the current account. The current account. The second one, we have monetary account. Account. The third one, we have capital account. Those are the structure of balance of payment. So we are going to discuss the current account. And the current account has a feasible and invisible goods. So first of all, current account is the exchange of currently produced goods and services. These are the currently produced goods and services, and they are visible or invisible. So invisible and visible. So visible are goods and invisible are services. Services which you can't see there. And we have the monetary account. And monetary account are the financial transactions of government. These are the financial transactions of government. And this includes the transaction in IMF, the transactions in Central Bank of Kenya, the transaction between the government of Kenya, maybe Kenya and China, or Kenya and France, or Kenya and USA. So those are the monetary accounts. So we go to capital accounts, and capital account is transactions arising from capital movements in and out of a country. These are the capital movements. Movements in and out of the country. So we are done with the structure of balance of payment. So we go to international liquidity. We are going to discuss what is international liquidity. So international liquidity means the availability of settling international currencies or international currencies or their debentures. So international liquidity includes gold, currency swap, borrowing facilities, foreign market, foreign exchange markets, and convertible national currencies. Those are examples of international liquidity. Those are what can be used globally in currencies. So those includes gold, currency swap, borrowing facilities, including IMF, Central Bank, or we have also the foreign exchange markets. This foreign exchange market is a place whereby if you have a dollar, you can go there and be given Kenyan shillings, or be given pounds, or be given yens and other currencies. So we go to exchange rates. So exchange rate is a rate at which one country can exchange from one price to another. That is one price of the price of this country and the price of the other country. That's the rate at which that price fluctuates. So we have the factors determining the exchange rates. We have the increase in demand of exports. The factors affecting the exchange rates, the increase in demand of exports. So if export increase, the level of exchange decreases. And we import more, the level of the percentage of exchange decreases. So we have inflation also affects, and government activities also affects the exchange rates. Also corruption affects exchange rates in international trade. So we go to the last topic in international trade, that is IMF. And what is IMF? What is IMF? You will research what is IMF. What I just tell you, IMF is International Monetary Fund, and we have objectives of IMF. And objective number one of IMF is to work through full convertibility of currencies. They work through full convertibilities of currencies. The second one is they stabilize exchange rates between currencies. Maybe a currency between dollar and shillings, IMF stabilizes it. Also, IMF gives short-term assistance to countries. They give short-term loans to countries. And to achieve these objectives of working towards full convertibility of currency, stabilizing the exchange rates, and giving the short-term assistance to countries. So IMF should make sure that countries are not restricted on their trades. They make sure that countries should adopt the system of exchange rate. They should also reserve the right to dedicate the country's borrowing from time to time. Also, IMF should confirm if a member is a state of IMF or if a country is contributing to IMF for a short-term assistance. So that comes to an end of the last topic, international trade. And also we have come to the final touches of economics. We are done with economics, and there are so many questions you can be asked on this unit, all the way from, we start from introduction to economics. You can be asked what are economic goals. And economic goals are controlling of inflation, controlling of unemployment, controlling of economic growth, and attaining a favorable balance of payment. Those are economic goals. You can be asked to discuss what are economic goals. You can also be asked to define terms like scarcity, choice, and opportunity cost. So scarcity, we said, scarcity are the goods or services that cannot be enough to fill anyone's wants or needs. And choice is choice involves sacrifices, and choice can be made about which way or a want can satisfy you. And an opportunity cost is an item measured in alternatives in prices. Opportunity cost are measured in prices. You can choose to take this good of a lower price or this good at a higher cost. You can also be asked to define the features of free enterprises. We have specialization and exchange. You can be asked what is the meaning of specialization and stages of labor specialization. So specialization is whereby individuals specialize in production of one commodity, and there are stages. Stage number one, there is craft, number two is process, number three is regional specialization, and the fourth one is international division of labor. Those are the stages of specialization. So there is theory of demand and supply. You can be asked to draw a curve of demand or a supply. So we say that demand curve slopes from left to right, and a supply curve slopes from right to left. And this is equilibrium. And what we say equilibrium is the price at which suppliers are willing to supply to the market at a given price, and the price that consumers are willing to pay to a product. So that is an equilibrium. Can we ask to mention some causes of the factors influencing supply, factors influencing demand, and also you can be asked also to define or to discuss the factors affecting labor, subpopulation, age, working, education, and remuneration. Can be also asked to discuss the barriers to mobility and factor of production. So generally, this unit is not hard. This unit is not hard. It's very easy when you read, and when you revise well, it's very easy. So we have come to the end of this unit, economics, and I'm expecting all of you to revise well. I'll be sharing also the revision kits, the past papers, and we'll revise together in the next lesson. So, students, thank you for your time. I really appreciate. Let's meet in the next lesson to discuss some of the past papers, some of the questions, and we answer them. Yes, that's the end. Thank you for your time. Let's meet.